A family man, Wade Porter, is living the American dream. He is a hardworking small business owner of a small town construction company in Santa Fe, New Mexico. He lives with his fiancée Laura and their 3-year-old son Michael. As the movie begins, we learn that he is planning their wedding and that he was just approved for a small business loan. For Wade and Laura, everything seems to be going their way. So what could go wrong? One night while sleeping, they are awakened by an intruder. As Wade searches the house, the intruder runs past him. Wade chases him outside. Thinking that he has a weapon, Wade hits him in the head, killing him. The police arrive and discover that the intruder didn't have a weapon. He had Wade's wallet in his hand. Because the intruder had no weapon and was running away, he was no longer a threat. Wade is arrested and charged with murder. While in a holding pen at the county jail, Wade looks at an inmate, Viper, the wrong way and is attacked. There's a riot occurring at San Quentin State Prison that was started by a notorious inmate named John Smith. The prison wants to put Smith in the hole for life, but a retired captain named Gordon gets him transferred instead. Wade's murder charge is reduced to manslaughter, and he is sentenced to 3 years in prison. While on a bus to state prison, Danny Sampson, the leader of the gang, the Aryan Brotherhood, viciously attacks another inmate. He passes his weapon to Snowman, who is a member of the Skinheads, and wipes his bloody hands on his clothes. As the bus pulls into the prison, Snowman passes the weapon to Wade and tells him to say that he found it under his seat, or else he will be whacked. When Wade is caught with the weapon, he says that he found it under the seat. Wade is later interrogated by Lieutenant Jackson and his officers, who tell him that the inmate who was stabbed on the bus is in critical condition, and if he dies, he will be charged with accessory to murder. But if he tells who did the stabbing, he will be in the clear. Wade, fearing that he will suffer the same fate as the inmate who was stabbed on the bus, decides not to tell. Wade is then sent to the SHU, the Security Housing Unit, where the worst of the worst inmates are held. They are locked in their cells 23 hours a day and only allowed 1 hour of recreation, which takes place in a small concrete yard. The scene cuts to a meeting with Lieutenant Jackson, the warden, and Officer Collins. Collins, a former Army Ranger, is being assigned to the SHU. On Wade's first day in the yard, two inmates begin fighting. But instead of the fight being broken up, Lieutenant Jackson and his officers let it continue and make wagers on who will win. When the fight is over, Lieutenant Jackson has his officer shoot the inmates with rubber bullets. Officer Collins, who is new to the unit, is disturbed by what he is seeing. Wade's fiancée Laura comes to visit and has to endure a humiliating strip search. She is out of money and can't find a good paying job. Wade tells her to use the checks from the small business loan to get by until he figures something out. Wade gets a cellmate, John Smith, the inmate who started the riot at San Quentin. Smith is in prison for killing 16 people. His wife and daughter were murdered, which sent him on a rampage. He killed the entire families of the two men who killed his wife and daughter, so that they would know the pain that he felt by losing his family. He then killed the two men. He wanted the death penalty, but was given life without parole. Lieutenant Jackson, who is not impressed by his reputation, takes the only picture he has of his wife and daughter to show him who's boss. The next day in the yard, Wade is greeted by Snowman, the skinhead who passed him the weapon on the bus. They praise him for not squealing and tell him to continue to do as he's told and they will protect him. Wade sees that Smith is not in a gang. When they get back to the cell, Wade asks him how he survives without being in a gang. Smith, seeing that Wade is new to prison, gives him a lesson in prison politics. He explains, "For white inmates, if it's not white, it ain't right. Prison is not about street gangs. It's about race." The Hispanics are cut in half. There are Northerners and Southerners, who are always at war. With the blacks, they have a mixture of gangs that pretty much forget their beefs and unite with the Asians and Pacific Islanders. Don't bother trying to figure out who's who. They all hate you. Then you've got the skins and the woods. Nearly all the whites follow the Aryan Brotherhood, who run the show. The gangs underneath them will try to recruit you, build up their numbers, get you to sling their drugs, stab who they don't like. Pay attention to who's calling the shots with the whites. They'll tell you to do something, and if you don't handle business, they'll handle you. The next day in the yard, Snowman orders Wade to fight with another inmate. Wade receives a visit from Laura and his son Michael. Laura notices that Wade has shaved his head and is acting strange. She asks him if he's become a Nazi or a skinhead. Wade tells her that she wouldn't understand, but refuses to explain. She has again run out of money. Wade tells her to sell his truck, tools, and their house. Every day afterwards in the yard, Snowman orders Wade to fight. Until the day when Wade has had enough and refuses. Snowman and the other skinheads jump Wade. Smith comes to Wade's aid. The next day, the leader of the Aryan Brotherhood, Danny Sampson, the one who stabbed the inmate on the bus, is in the yard. He motions to Wade to come over. Snowman starts to berate Wade. Sampson tells Snowman to shut up. Sampson tells Snowman that he saw him pass the weapon to Wade on the bus. Then Snowman is slashed across the face and beaten by the Aryan Brotherhood. Afterwards, Sampson tells Wade that the other white inmates will not touch him, and if he ever wants to join the Aryan Brotherhood, to let him know. Laura visits Wade and tells him that she sold his truck, his tools, and the house, but wasn't able to get the price for the house that they wanted. This causes an argument and Laura walks out. Snowman meets with Lieutenant Jackson and agrees to testify against Sampson as an eyewitness to the stabbing on the bus. In turn, Jackson agrees to place Snowman in protective custody for the rest of his prison term. The next day in the yard, Wade is attacked, but refuses to fight, which upsets Lieutenant Jackson and provokes him to shoot Wade several times with rubber bullets. Later in the infirmary, Lieutenant Jackson tells Wade that the inmate that Sampson stabbed on the bus died, and Snowman has agreed to testify as an eyewitness against Sampson, and that Sampson will go down for first-degree murder and Wade will be charged as an accessory to murder for having the weapon. Sampson is convicted and is sentenced to life without the possibility of parole. Wade is convicted of accessory and sentenced to an additional 6 years due to Lieutenant Jackson's testimony. Laura's mother convinces her to leave Wade. With his hopes of being released after serving his original sentence shattered and Laura leaving him, Wade becomes a complete savage and viciously beats an inmate and joins the Aryan Brotherhood. If things weren't bad enough, Viper, the inmate that attacked Wade in the county jail, is transferred to the SHU. Laura has a change of heart and makes up with Wade. Hopeful again, Wade asks Smith to help him come up with a way to get out of prison. Smith explains that he can get his sentence commuted if he's got something to barter with. He needs to expose Lieutenant Jackson, so they come up with a plan. Wade has Laura reach out to Smith's friend, retired Captain Gordon. Wade then asks Lieutenant Jackson to let him fight Viper in the yard. Jackson agrees to let Wade fight Viper, but tells Wade that it will be a fight to the death. The next day in the yard, Wade and Viper begin to fight. It's a back and forth battle until Wade gets the upper hand. But refuses to kill Viper. This angers Lieutenant Jackson, who fires a warning shot at Wade. Lieutenant Jackson orders Wade to kill Viper and levels the rifle at Wade. But before he pulls the trigger, Smith steps in front of Wade. Then all the other inmates who are fed up with Lieutenant Jackson step in front of Wade. But Jackson is not willing to let it go. He orders all the inmates to leave the yard except for Wade and Smith. Then Officer Diaz turns off the surveillance cameras. Lieutenant Jackson's plan is to kill Wade, frame Smith for Wade's murder, and then have Officer Diaz shoot and kill Smith from the tower. Officer Collins, who has finally had enough of Lieutenant Jackson's abuse of power, turns the surveillance cameras back on. As Lieutenant Jackson raises his weapon to stab Wade, Smith slashes Jackson and Officer Diaz shoots Smith. Officer Collins rings the alarm just as Laura, Gordon, and the FBI special agent arrive at the prison. The agent confiscates the video of the yard and launches a federal investigation. For his cooperation, Wade's additional 6-year sentence is commuted, leaving him to serve just the 3 months remaining of his original sentence. Snowman, who was promised by Lieutenant Jackson that he would serve the rest of his term in protective custody, is informed that Jackson's dead and that he is transferred back to the SHU and placed in the cell with Danny Sampson. 3 months later, Wade is released from prison.